Welcome to the third day of Advent. Today we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 6 verses 20 through 26 and how it relates to Advent. We'll be reading from the book by Bonhoeffer on his Advent reflections. Then we'll be doing some of our own reflection, and then finally we'll close with the song, O Come Emmanuel. Let's begin with the reading today from the Gospel of Luke. Then he looked up at his disciples and he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and revile you and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what the ancestors did to the prophets." Bonhoeffer writes this: "Not everyone can wait. Neither the sated nor the satisfied, nor those without respect can wait. The only ones that can wait are people who carry a restlessness around with them and people who look up to the reverence to the greatest in the world. Thus, Advent can be celebrated only by those whose souls give them no peace, who know that they are poor and incomplete, who sense something of the greatness that is supposed to come, before which they can only bow in humble timidity, waiting until he inclines himself towards us, the Holy One himself, God in the child in the manger. God is coming. The Lord Jesus is coming. Christmas is coming. Rejoice, O Christendom." Bonhoeffer wrote from a prison cell in Germany, "I think we're going to have an exceptionally good Christmas. The very fact that every outward circumstance precludes our making provision for it will show whether we can be content with what is truly essential. I used to be very fond of thinking up and buying presents, but now that we have nothing to give, the gift God gave us in the birth of Christ will seem all the more glorious. The emptier our hands, the better we understand what Luther meant by his dying words. We're beggars. It's true. The poorer our quarters, the more clearly we perceive that our hearts should be Christ's home on earth." For those who don't know Bonhoeffer and his story, he is a Lutheran priest and theologian in Germany during World War II. His writing on Christianity's role in the secular world had become widely influential, and his book, The Cost of Discipleship, has been seen as one of the 20th century books that every Christian should read. I know I've read it twice, and it's highly influenced the way I think about what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. But Bonhoeffer was not only a priest and theologian. He was what very few Germans did. They stood up against Hitler and the Nazi regime. Bonhoeffer was known for his staunch resistance to the Nazi dictatorship, including vocal opposition to Hitler's euthanasia program and the genocide and persecution of the Jews. He was arrested in April 1943 by the Gestapo and imprisoned until the Nazis had him killed just before the end of World War II. Hitler hated him so much that he had him hanged just so that he wouldn't be freed when the Allied forces came in to Germany. But while in prison under SS Guard, he continued to write, and so influenced the SS Guards that they started sneaking his writings out of the prison. So when he writes about his outward circumstances that preclude making any provision, he is locked up in a cell by the SS Guards, writing letters that he has no idea if they will ever be delivered. Yet in his current condition, he's come to understand the true meaning of Christmas and of Christ's gift to humanity. I love the end of this letter. "The poorer our quarters, the more clearly we perceive that our hearts should be Christ's home on earth." I don't know about your journey through life and experience of Christmas, but I find it ironic that the more stuff we have, the harder it is to find the true meaning of Christmas. As a father, I cherish those handmade gifts of my children so much more than the latest $2,000 gift, gadget, or trinket. I yearn for the days of handmade crayon-colored cards when you were broke and the latest, rather than the latest poetic words off of a $7 Hallmark wrap. See, our Christmas was never supposed to be so commercialized, but we've let our consumer culture ruin the humble timidity which is required to face the truth that God came to earth in the form of a vulnerable child. In an era where Herod could simply call for the murder of every male child under the age of 2, and it simply happened. He was born into a dangerous time that we can't even fathom, to a young woman who should have been stoned to death for getting pregnant outside of marriage, because that's what the law said. The idea that God's only son was not welcomed at the Grand Hotel, but was born basically in the basement where the animals are kept, should cause us a restless in us as we remember and celebrate his birth. We should rejoice that even under these circumstances, the Holy One himself, God in the child, born in the manger, decided still to come. God is coming. The Lord Jesus is coming. Christmas is coming, and there is nothing that all the advertisers selling fancy cards can do about it. Rejoice that Emmanuel, God with us, will be celebrated once again. All who are hated and reviled for calling on the name of the Lord, rejoice. Rejoice and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, as Emmanuel shall come to thee and fill your soul with an assurance that no earthly gift can bring. Speaking of inviting Emmanuel into our lives, would you please join me in praying through the first verse of O Come, Emmanuel, as we close the message today. O God, we humbly come before you with restless anticipation of what is to be. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Let us leap for joy with the assurance that Emmanuel has come to set us free. Amen.